welcome. Hope all is well, Prof.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wonderful. The ball is in your court now.
Yeah, yeah, that's okay. Right. Okay. Right. Good evening, listeners. Well, as you've heard from my boss, we're going to interact this evening on measurement and evaluation and statistics in education. The course code is EDCR361. Yeah, for this evening, what we're going to do is that before, by the end of the lesson, you will get an understanding about what assessment, measurement, testing, evaluation is. And we'll also look at the principles and purpose of assessment, as well as assessment of learning, assessment as learning, and assessment for learning. That's Asare Amua. And for the next 1 hour, we'll be interacting. Yes, as you've already heard, it's about the nature definitions and explanation of these basic concepts. Now, I'll start with assessment. We'll be hearing about assessment. We talk about assessment. You've dealt with assessment, right from KG up to the university level. Let us try to get an understanding about what assessment is all about. Like my boss said, after the interaction, you can call on 0503-923-158. The studio lines, and then WhatsApp and text will be 0503-923-158. And on a landline, we have 0332-320201. 0332-320201. So like I already said, I'll begin by trying to explain what assessment is all about. Our course outline is the first unit. And we should have done this last week, but because of the special congregation, there were some changes. That's why we're having it today. Right goal, assessment, generally is a broad term defined as a process for obtaining information that is used for making decisions about student, curricular programs, and educational policies. So in a nutshell, that's all about assessment. Trying to get information about students. We're going to narrow our discussion to the classroom. So most of the time, example I'll be giving will be focused in the classroom. But I can do assessment also in the classroom as well. But basically what it is getting information and using information to make decisions. Right. In the classroom, decisions about students include managing classroom instructions. Yes, we take decisions to help you manage your classroom interaction. Placing students into different types of educational programs. Again, decision about students on selecting them for educational opportunities. Yes. Yeah, in the third year, very soon go out for the outside. When you come back, when it's time and you get your results, you may want to further your education. Yes. So it's based on assessment that this can be done. And again, when we talk about decision making, it's about assigning students to appropriate categories, as well as guiding and counseling. And most importantly, since you are here, decision that can be made from assessment is about you being given certificates or certifying your competence, right? So basically, that's what assessment is all about. And like I said, we collect information from you. We collect information every time. And making a decision out of such information that we collect is assessment. That's all. Right. But there's so many strategies that can be used when you're assessing. We have strategies and techniques. And in the classroom, principally, we need to get information about knowledge, skills, attitudes, or behaviors to be learned. Yes, your lecturers, your instructors, your tutors, they take you through series of activities. And at the end, they need to find out whether you've acquired some knowledge through those activities, whether you've developed some skills, or whether you've developed some attitudes or behavior to be learned. So, from this, you could see that when we're assessing learners, students, testees, we try to get information about their knowledge level, the skills that were acquired, their attitudes or behaviors to be learned. Like I said, assessment encompasses all the strategies and techniques. Under the strategies, we're trying to look at how we assess. And this can be done through observations, paper and pencil tests, oral questioning, interviews, peer and self-assessment, portfolios, projects, exhibitions, and so on and so forth. So these are ways that we can collect information about learners, and then based on that, we make decisions about them. So when we get this information, inferences are drawn. I said earlier on about your knowledge level, your skills and attitudes, so that such information that we collect are valid and not open to misinterpretation. So we use these strategies to get information about learners. So that's about assessment and its strategies and techniques. But before you assess, there are some basic guidelines that you need to follow. One of the cardinal things about whoever is assessing needs to be clear about the learning target he or she wants to assess. Because an individual, day in, day out, the moment we get up from bed, you exhibit so many behaviors. So, for example, if I want to assess you, I need to be clear about what exactly do I want from you. So, the bottom line is that before you can assess a learner, a student, a testee, or an individual, you must know the kinds of knowledge you want, the skills that you want, the performance that you want, and the behavior that you want. You need to be clear in your mind. Otherwise, you go there, you assess it, at the end, you have multiple or a huge chunk of information. What are you going to do with it? So, you need to be clear about what you want before you go into assess. Another guideline is that one needs to be clear that the assessment techniques he or she selects actually match the learning target. Whatever technique you're going to use should match the learning target, what you're expecting from the learner. Yes, like I said, individuals exhibit a lot of behaviors at any particular point in time, and each of such behaviors can be assessed using a specific or a particular technique. So you need to be sure that this behavior or this knowledge or this skill that I want from the learner, this technique or this mechanism is the appropriate one. Otherwise, you will not get the right information that you want. That's all that we are talking about. I again, one needs to be sure that assessment techniques serve the needs of the learner. You should select assessment techniques that provide meaningful feedback to the learner about how closely they have approximated to the learning targets. Yes. Whatever technique that you select, whatever assessment that you do, feedback is cardinal. You need the learner to know about what actually took place. So feedback is very, very, very important. So in a nutshell, you have to be clear about what you want to assess, the technique that you want to use, and the type, the feedback should be meaningful to the learner. And to try to let the learner know that, yes, I was about getting such information and making a decision about you. You have it or you do not have it. So that the learner will also appreciate the assessment strategy, system. Again, whenever possible, be sure to use multiple indicators of performance for each learning target. This will provide a better assessment of the extent to which a student has achieved a given learning target. What that exactly means is that, yes, as you observe or as you assess student, multiple about a particular behavior, multiple indicators will point to that behavior. So we are saying that you need to be sure to know all those indicators that will point to a particular skill, a particular knowledge. As I was telling my students yesterday in class, if you're putting on the nose marks in class, some put it on well, some have this thing just at the tip of their nose, some below their nozzle, and then some below, just down their chin. So which one do you think is better? So you have these multiple indicators pointing to maybe wearing of nose marks or whatever they call it, face marks, sorry. So which one do you think? So you're going to see all these things, so you need to have a broader view about some of these things. Again, one of the guidelines is that one needs to be sure that when you interpret the results of assessment, you take their limitations into account. Yes. There are some assessment techniques that we use for each individual. For a particular individual, it will be appropriate. But another individual, it will not be appropriate as you do. So you need to take cognition of the fact that there are some limitations in some of these things. So when interpreting your results or when you're making a decision about it, you need to take that into consideration. So we're saying that assessment is a means to an end. It's not an end in itself. Assessment provides information upon which decisions are based. So whatever decision is taken based on assessment that we make. So generally, this is about assessment. So like I said, I'm narrowing this into the classroom. So most of my examples will come from the classroom. So we have these guidelines supporting how to do assessment. Having talked about that, and looking at the strategies, or pencil and paper type, oral interviews, and all these things, all these techniques. There is an omnibus name for SEC techniques. And we always hear about it. People talk about it. Almost every day we talk about it. And that term is test. As you listen to me, just step back and be thinking about what the test is all about. We've been taking tests, right? In KG, lower primary, upper primary, VHS, SHS, in the university year, first year, second year, third year, we continue taking tests. So ask yourself, what is a test? I think you need to understand it before. If you understand it and you are taking it, then you have a problem. But let's see how we can get information so that such problems do not haunt us. When we say a test, tests connotes the presentation of a standard set of questions to be answered. So, standard set of questions to be answered. So, in a test, you always have a stimulus and a response, the question and then the answer. The question that should be answered. But different views have been expressed on the test. I'm going to pick up one or two people and talk about how they look at what the test is all about. One of such individuals is Nitko. In 2001, he said, test is an instrument,
yes,
or systematic procedure for observing and describing one or more characteristics of a student using either a numerical scale or classification scheme. Yes. So what Nitko is saying, a test is an instrument. I said, what's a systematic procedure which is to observe and describe one or more kinds of an individual? That means for every student, for each individual, like I said earlier on, at any particular point that you exhibit myriad of a lot of many behaviors. And so tests can be used to measure that. That's what Nitko is saying. Again, I recently, 1991, said a test is a formal, systematic, usually paper and pencil procedure for gathering information about people's behavior. Yes. So it's a procedure for gathering information. Like I said right from the start, when we talk about assessments, about getting information, gathering information, making a decision about it. So a test is a tool, it's an instrument that is used to get such an information. So you see that there's that link between a test, assessment being getting the information, and test being the instrument that is used to gather such information for decision making. So in schools, we usually think of a test as a paper and pencil instrument with a series of questions that students must answer. So like I said earlier on, we have some stimuli and a student has to, that demands responses. So you have your questions and you must answer them. These tests are usually scored by adding together the points a student earn on each question. Thus, they describe the student using a numerical scale. But there are some characteristics that are very difficult. We'll be looking at it very soon when we start talking about Benjamin. There are certain characteristics that you cannot, as an individual, look at the face of the student and determine. But such behaviors can be exhibited through a test. And then whoever is assessing will convey such behaviors by assigning numerical values to it, to give the meaning or to give the extent to which that characteristic is exhibited by the learner. So that's about, we have different types of tests. And tests are classified by using a criteria like the purpose of the test, the uses of the tests, and the nature of the tests. So, we're going to explain these three terms in very simple language. What is it? You're using a test for a purpose. It means that the criteria of the test can be classified as achievement tests. I'll be explaining achievement very soon. Diagnostic test that's trying to find, the strengths and weaknesses of an individual. Aptitude tests, intelligent tests, etc., etc. So we use the test for that purpose. And using a test, we'll talk about two uses of it. And they are classified as a non-reference test and criterion reference test. The non-reference test is one that the scores, the results of the test of an individual is used to compare with the performance of the other individual who took the test. That's where in some tests we rank them. This one is first, this one is second, this one is third. Yes, we're using the performance of each individual against the group. So that is, we call that a norm reference, the test. And our criteria reference test, that is, there may be a standard what each individual is expected to develop. That criteria is set as a minimum skill development of the individual. And when we're using criteria reference test, we have certain that standard. If you don't achieve that standard, you don't move on. And then we have nature of a test, and that one is used as a criterion test that can be classified as paper and pencil, oral test, performance test, etc., etc. So these are the types of tests that we have. And like I said, all these things, the references are made to the classrooms. It can be also, but then our discussion interaction is focused in the classroom. Now, like I said earlier on, I told you that we have two types of what? Assessment, achievement tests. I'm going to look at what achievement test is all about. So I'll start talking about what an achievement test is. When we talk about achievement tests, I will explain one of the types of tests, right? When we talk about achievement tests, it's a test designed to measure formal or school-taught learning. Yes. Collect information about the classroom experiences. Yes. So we say that achievement tests measure the degree of student learning in specific curricular areas in which instruction has been received. Now, if I say I'm going to assess you, let's say on unit one. So I just want to find how you've achieved or how you've developed skills or how you've updated your knowledge in that unit. Whatever I do is normally referred to as achievement test. However, achievement tests are a measure of previously acquired knowledge. Normally, you have to acquire the knowledge before we try to get such information from you. So achievement tests are designed to measure the extent to which a person has achieved, gained, attained, mastered certain skills as a result of specific instructions and learning. We have two forms of achievement, teacher-made tests and standardized tests. which you can read about them as you go along. The next concept that I wanted to talk about is, as a course, as you see the course, is what? Measurement, evaluation, and statistics. So the next thing I will talk about is measurement. What is measurement? You've heard about it. You heard about it from your seniors. Yeah, for measurement, measurement, evaluation, for measurement. What is measurement? Measurement generally is a process of quantifying the degree to which someone or something possesses a given character's quality or feature. Again, most authorities agree that measurement is assigning of numbers, numerals, or symbols to the traits or characters of a person or event according to specific rule. What that simply means is that, like I said earlier on, when I say or tell a student that it's acquired this amount of knowledge, I cannot look straight into the face of the learner and say that you have this quantity or that quantity. No. What I can do is that I give you a test and I try to assign numbers to the estimation of those characteristics. So at the end, when I add all those the quantified score, it gives me a feel of how much that you have in your mind. And that's all about measurement. It's assigning of numbers to characteristics according to specified rules. The rule should be for everybody. You can't use one particular rule for a particular student, another rule for another. No. Yes, you want to measure the ability level, the knowledge that they've acquired. The rule should be applied to all of them. Again, NITCO, 2001. That guy is a very strong guy in measurement and assessment. He defined measurement as a procedure for assigning numbers, usually called scores, to a specified attribute or characteristics of a person in such a way that the numbers describe the degree to which the person possesses the attribute. Yes. So it's all about assigning of numbers to characteristics. So in terms of assessment, you need to define, you need to know exactly what you want to measure. They tend to assign numbers to them. However, in measurement, depending upon the traits or characters and the way they are measured, different data results, you get different information. And they represent different scales of measurement. So the information that you're going to collect they have differences. And the data resource or the variable that you come out with, we're going to talk about, there are a lot of them, but we're talking about only four categories of such scale data. And different rules apply at each scale of measurement. And each scale detects certain types of statistical procedure. Like if you read from the, what do you call it, the course outline put on your V class. And the objective. The last object is going to be the processing, how to process, analyze, interpret, and use assessment results or test scores for further decision. Yes, over there, you do some small statistics, small calculations based in statistics. And we're going to want to get to that point. We'll be talking more about this type of what skills. So the type of information that we normally get, called the ratio, the data that we normally get, we have the ratio data, the interval, ordinal, the nominal. These skills are hierarchical. Nominal being the lowest and the ratio being the highest. The nominal skill, generally, as assigning numbers to certain characteristics for identification and categorization sake. Krish, you give the numbers, you assign numbers to certain characteristics just for identification and categorization. Let me give you an example. So most of you have been watching football matches recently. I know you are from fans, Chelsea fans, and they will watch the final of the UEFA Cup, and then you saw some numbers at the back of the players. Those numbers there are only used for identification purposes. The numbers are used to represent the individuals, but the numbers do not have numerical value or relationship. What that means is that if you see a player of number 5 at the back and another player of number 10 at his back, it doesn't mean that the player of 10 is better than the player of the number 5. No. These numbers are just for identification sake. And normally, when we are talking about data, nominal data, we tend to give numbers. For example, there are sort of collecting some data, we tend to give, let's say, assign number like 1 for males, 2 for females, or 2 for males, 1 for females. It does not make any change because the numbers are only for identification purposes. Just that. If I have 5 at my back, someone has 2 at the back, that doesn't mean that I'm better than. There's no quality in this. They're just for identification purposes. The other skill, that's an ordinal skill. It means it's for measurement that contain the property of order. It provides some information about the order or rank of the variable, but it does not indicate how much better one score is than the other. This enables us to make statements using the phrase more than or less than. Just that. Then we have the interval scale. There are numerical scales in which we know both the order and the exact differences between the values. One characteristic of this skills is that when we take the nominal, the 4 algebraic expression cannot be used. You cannot add, cannot subtract, cannot multiply, cannot divide. When we talk about interval, we are saying that there are numerical values in which we know both the order and the exact difference between the variables. The interval scale has no starting point. We call it, it has an arbitrary point. An example of an interval scale is a Fahrenheit temperature scale because of its equality of units. For instance, the difference between 30 and 34 is the same as between 72 to 76, the difference of 4. With a ratio scale, it incorporates all of the characteristics of the interval scale with one important addition, an absolute zero. It has a starting point, absolute zero. In the case of interval, the starting point is arbitrary. Example of ratio scales are height, weight, time, distance. That has an absolute zero point. So, under the ratio scale, you can make statements like twice as long as or half of as fast as. Because over here, you can add, subtract, multiply, and divide. So, this is about some of the skills of measurement. Let's quickly talk about evaluation. Because in the core, the task and the name of the course has measurement and evaluation. In this course, again, it's over here. He's saying that evaluation is defined as a process of making a value judgment about the worth of a student product or performance. What does that mean? Simply, what it's trying to say is that when you make value judgments about a score or an information that you've collected, the main concern of evaluation in the classroom is to arrive at a judgment on the worth or effectiveness of the teaching and learning. So, someone gets 60%. Now, if you make a statement, you make a statement like excellent or very good, it means you are making judgment. So that's about evaluation. That's about evaluation. We have two forms of evaluation. We have a formative evaluation and summative evaluation. Formative evaluation is judgment about quality or worth made during the design or development of instructional materials, instructional procedures, curricula, or educational programs. The evaluator directs this judgment towards modifying, forming, or otherwise improving the product before it is widely used in schools. So when we talk about formative evaluation, all I say is that the teacher engages when revising lessons or learning material by using information obtained from their previous use. So as you see right now, for a final assessment, we put pieces together. You're given quizzes, given teacher assessment, you take end of semester exam. And aggregation of all these gives you a final. So the assessment is done in piecemeal, and then at the end, we give. But when we talk about summative evaluation, it is when judgment about the quality or worth of an already is done at the end of a unit. For example, if the whole semester you go for lectures and nothing is given you, no assessment is given, and assessment is given at the end of the semester, we call it what? Summative evaluation. We call it summative evaluation. Sometimes we speak of summative evaluation of students, but this we mean judging the quality or worth of a student's achievement after the instructional process is completed. So, summative evaluation achievement normally is done at the end of a course or a unit. Then when I was starting, I said I would talk about the purpose of a test. So the purpose of assessment. I'll be talking about three of such. We have assessment of learning, assessment for learning, assessment as learning. So I'm going to give a brief interpretation to these three concepts, and then what the teacher needs to do in each of these principles. When we talk of assessment of learning, what we are saying is that the purpose of assessments of learning is usually summative and is mostly done at the end of a task, unit of work, at the end of a unit, term, or semester, and may be used to rank or grade students. So, when we talk about assessments of learning, we're dealing with summative type of assessment. This is designed to provide evidence of achievement to parents, other educators, the students themselves, and sometimes to outside groups, e.g. employers and that kind of thing. It is actually designed primarily to serve the purposes of accountability or ranking or of satisfying competence. Right. What is the teacher's role? How can the teacher support this in the classroom? Effective assessment requires that teacher provide a rationale for undertaking a particular assessment of learning at a particular point in time. Why are you doing the assessment at this particular point? How beneficial would that assessment be? How is it going to contribute to the student understanding of himself or herself, the parents, and so on and so forth? So for a teacher, you need to give a clear description of the intended learning. What exactly do you want from the student? Because the students are going to use it to support their learning. And as a teacher, you need to ensure that the processes that makes it possible for students to demonstrate their competence and skills. Yeah, like I said earlier on, in assessment, a particular skill, we cannot use one particular strategy or instrument to measure all skills. No. Certain techniques or instruments will be appropriate to measure a particular skill. So we say that as a teacher, you need to become clear about that. And you need to give a range of alternatives. And again, whatever decision that you make should be defensible. And you need a transparent approach to it. Now let's talk about assessment for learning. An assessment for learning is for which the first priority is designed and practice is to serve the purpose of promoting student learning. It should promote student learning. And in this type of assessment, teachers use evidence about student knowledge, understanding, and skill to inform their teaching. So for assessment for learning, very important for the learner as well as the teacher. And sometimes referred to as the formative assessment. It usually occurs throughout the teaching and learning process to clarify student learning and understanding. An assessment for learning, students should understand exactly what they are to learn, what is expected of them, and are giving feedback and advice on how to improve their work. So, like I said, for both the teacher, assessment that comes up for this, both for the teacher and the learner, the teacher uses to guide his teaching, the learner also uses to guide his learning. So what does the teacher do? The teacher should engage students in an interactive way because the resource is very important to both of them. The teacher should be able to identify a particular learning needs of students and ensure that his teaching will enable students to acquire these skills. Appropriate teacher learning materials are expected to be used by the teacher. Individual differences should be taken care of. And most importantly, there should be an immediate feedback and direction to students. Now let's go to the last one, assessment as learning. As long as learning occurs when students are their own assessors. That is, their results support them to monitor their own learning, ask questions, and use a range of strategies to decide what they know and can do, and how to use assessment for new learning. So we are saying that assessment for as learning has a that this thing to support them to learn about themselves as learners and become aware of how they learn. That is, become metacognitive knowledge of one's own thought processes. So assessment as learning helps students to take more responsibility for their own learning and monitoring future directions. So you could see that for all these three purposes of assessment, assessment as learning is primarily to support the student manage his learning. Assessment for learning is for both the teacher and the student to collaboratively come together and see how each can support the other. An assessment of learning is primarily for decision making about parents and the rest. So there are certain questions that one student need to ask themselves when it comes to assessment learning. They need to ask themselves the purpose of their learning. What do I know about this topic? What story do I know that will help me learn this? Am I understanding these questions? These are some of the reflective questions that students should be asking themselves, because whatever results that comes out is supposed to guide them move forward. What is the teacher's role over here? The teacher's role in promoting the development of independent learners through assessment as learning is to model and teach the skills of self-assessment, because over here, students are to do a lot of self-assessment. They need to step back, reflect, understand themselves, develop better understanding about the skills that they can use for them to know why they are learning and how they can learn well. Another way that a teacher can do is to guide students in setting their own goals, and also to support them to know how to monitor their progress towards their learning. The teacher is to provide examples and models of good practice and quality work that reflect curriculum outcomes. They are to work with students to develop clear criteria of good practice. So that's the teacher's role. Again, the teacher is to guide students in developing internal feedback or self-monitoring mechanisms to validate and question their own thinking and to become comfortable with ambiguity and uncertainty. That is inevitably in learning anything new. That is, the teacher is to support the learner to be creative themselves. They should be creative thinkers. They should have the skill of problem solving. Again, like I said earlier on, they should support them to develop good model, good practice, and how to be able to self-assess themselves. On this note, I'll end here. Or let me pause here and wait for comments, questions, contributions. to this first unit of nature definition and explanation of basic concepts in assessment. Thank you. The WhatsApp line 0503 92 3158. Thank you. Your call doesn't get through. You can put down your questions when we meet at the lecture theater. The lecture will spend about the first 10 minutes to answer questions that you did not get feedback on. No questions, no contributions are coming. I thank you all for listening. And like I said, if your lines didn't get through, just put down whatever that you intend to ask. So we'll meet your lectures. Our lectures, they will support you to get answers to them. Thank you.